learned to practice religious liberty with others in their community, like Catholics, Buddhists, and others. We fight for religious liberty, but we have a difficulty of extending religious liberty to the person next to us in a pew.
Amen. That's
true. I was at a church in Northern California, near where Des Ford came to after he was fired from Pasadena College or let go. And boy, my church split right down the middle. You could just see it coming. Des Ford people over here and Weimar people over here. And I went with the Weimar group. I spent 20 years camping in the wilderness, so to speak, in dry and dusty places. And I think we missed a lot of grace this way, but it had been better if we had realized Norman and then somehow Norman together.
Yeah.
So it's okay to have differences, but then you have to kind of work them through. Or what happens? Well, my church split, and it's no longer there. There's no church there. It's gone. Whole church gone. They sold the building. I mean, I was a teenager going through this, watching this, and then watching my building go, I'm thinking, man, that's my church. Now I know what it feels so much to be a divorced child. You know, my parents were divorced, but my church got divorced. And I tell you, I'd rather see people fight it out.
Yeah.
Face to face, no backstabbing. Work through those. And if then you can't, okay, if we have a good fight and several years of it, and it's peaceful and much fun. Extending religious liberty to people. I mean, Paul the Apostle, talk about a dogmatic individual. Who could come in and say, you better believe what I believe. He has this great line that shows how much he needs to know. If any man is otherwise minded, the Lord will reveal it unto him. Boy, that takes a lot of courage to do that. So storming is very, very important. And I think if you're a team leader, you need to look. If you know there's some disagreement, you need to say, Janet, we're starting our meeting. And several sessions ago, you talked about how you're opposed to the uniform, about individuality. In the last couple of meetings, we haven't heard from you. And I realize you might be changing your mind, but I just wanted to make sure that, have you had time to state your opinion? Well, I'm glad you asked, Wayno. You have time to express yourself and storm it out, disagree. And that's hard to do. I mean, I know as a parent, like, oh, my kid, you need that much for you. Okay, I'm going to do it for you. Oh, it's going to hurt. Okay. But that's part of storming, because the only way she's going to be on my team, the only way you're going to be on the team, is if we give them voice and look for the storming. I mean, this is where you have to be honest. I had a person call me yesterday. She is the director at University of Notre Dame in a major program. She's in our PhD program. She's at the stage where she's doing a dissertation. She said, you know, my regional group really doesn't mean much to me anymore. I go to them because I have to, because the program requires it, but they don't mean anything to me. And so I'm listening to her. She says, you know, I really think I don't want to go anymore. And I just want to let you know, I asked your opinion. Well, I said, I'm glad that you asked my opinion. That shows that you're thinking about this, because you could have just, it's not gone, but you realize it is a requirement. And I've seen this before where, you know, at the dissertation stage, you feel like nobody else is at that stage and you go get feedback. I said, well, let me give you two metaphors. I said, well, like a family. Let's view your regional group like a family. You're in a family, and sometimes your family doesn't really do much for you lately, you know? So, you know, you feel like you're bringing home the money, you're taking care of the lawn, you're doing all the work, you wonder where your spouse is, you wonder where your kids are, and they're watching TV all the time, and you're thinking, man, I'm just putting out, nobody's putting in, I'm not getting anything out of this group. And you're like, there's times like you feel that way. I said, now, you can say goodbye to them if you want. That's always a choice, of course. Everybody has a choice. But have they helped you in the past? And is there a likelihood you might need them in the future? You know, I always do the Kleenex rule. When you're sick and you can't reach the Kleenex, it's always nice to have your family there. Because at least your 10-year-old daughter will get the Kleenex for you. Maybe she just does more for you than you think. And so I gave her that story, trying to calm her down, trying to reconnect her with her team, because she's stormy, but she's stormy to me. So I gave her the family metaphor, and then I sent her loose on her group. I said, at your next group meeting, you need to tell them how you feel. Don't tell me, tell them. Oh. You know what that means? She has to face them and say, you know, you guys really don't do anything for me. I think she started realizing, well, no, you need to tell them what you think, and then tell them what you need to get out of the group to make it meaningful to you. You have to storm. You have to step up. You have to ask. You have to tell. And you have to listen. So this is difficult.
I don't know if it's difficult for all Adventists, but I've noticed it's difficult in Adventist communities. In public school system, I have to admit, there's, you know, they cut. There are no niceties. They'll cuss if they want. They'll tell you what you think. And when I came to campus, I realized, you know, we need some of that. In Adventism, we don't have to be nice. We have to be loving. There's a huge difference. You know, you could speak your mind and love somebody.